And you are listening to the United We Strike Radio Marathon for March 8, 2014. I hope you enjoyed our presentation by David Frank. But now, I would normally be introducing Vinnie Eastwood and Susan Bozell. But Mr. Eastwood is playing hooky tonight. So if you're button-pushing, dial-spinning producer guy, Gary Hendershot, will be accompanying Suzanne in tonight's presentation. Suzanne, how you doing tonight?
I am awesome. How are you?
Awesome. I love you. That is such a catchphrase nowadays. I'm doing quite well, although I must admit the wind was coming from the north to the south, and I do live just 12 miles south of Washington, D.C., and I'll tell you, I was getting out my duct tape to tape up the window. But, you know, that's life in a big city. We get used to it.
We have the same thing, actually. It might be the same weather.
Might be the same Oh, for crying out loud. You know, I'm not sure why it does that, but... Okay, I'm sorry. I had a little bit of a technical glitch here with my player, and it was playing music over our introduction.
Oh.
I'm going to blame that on the software. That was certainly not user headspace error. The software obviously did that all by itself. In any case, you had a rather intriguing topic that you wanted to talk about, non-participation. How do I not participate in this thing? You know, I keep looking at it. You know, it's this system does not seem to be really serving my interests. So how would I withdraw my participation?
Well, it's very, very, very simple. It's so simple that it's almost a joke. Because when we think about non-participation, we think about boycotting certain corporations or, you know, not buying GMO as opposed to non-GMO. And those are actions that you take. But there's a whole psychology behind non-compliance that very few people ever talk about. And so I think the audience gets a little confused and sometimes a little frustrated about how are we supposed to not comply and how is that affecting real change in our world. And to be honest, the only way that we can get out of this is by not complying, because the whole system is set up so that your compliance keeps the machine going. And it's all done in your mind.
Well, I think it's assumed, too. They just, assume that unless I, you know, raise hell or put a target on my back and attract those guys in the Darth Vader suits to my door, unless I do something like that, I have given tacit agreement that I somehow am in agreement with everything. Yeah, so it's one of those situations where a lot of folks look at it and say, well, I'm damned if I do, damned if I don't. If I say nothing about it, then these guys assume that they have my tacit agreement. But if I stand on a soapbox and start saying, hell no, I'm not going to pay my taxes. Hell no, I'm not going to participate in murdering brown people all over the world. You know, I withdraw my, next thing you know, you got a bunch of guys in Darth Vader suits knocking on your door wanting to discuss things with you.
Absolutely. Well, that is part of the other tactic that keeps you in compliance. See, where this starts is, and I'm going to start you off with a little quote. It's not what they say, it's what you say to yourself after they're finished talking. That's where the sale comes in. That's where the guilt, the manipulation, the mind control. If they can say something to you that will get you to finish their half of the sentence in your mind, in other words, when they're finished talking, you go ahead and keep talking to yourself. They've got you. And there are multiple ways of doing this. There's neuro-linguistic programming. There is tonality. There is the sales pitch. And I want to remind people that just because they're dressed up like a news broadcaster or a celebrity or your favorite alternative media host does not mean that they're not a salesman. Everything is sales and marketing and investing. So when you realize that it's a product, and the product doesn't have to be a physical object, the products that I'm talking about are the ideas, the philosophies, the fear that keeps you in a state of reacting. That's the problem. We are making decisions based on an emotional response that we gave to some information that we heard. It doesn't matter any longer whether or not that information is true, because they use that little tactic that I was just talking about. They use little catchphrases and let you finish their sentence for them, because they know that if they say it just right, you'll think a certain thing, and that thought will elicit an emotional response, and that emotional response will be the basis of your next action. So if they keep us in a state of fear by scaring us into compliance, then we are finishing their sentence for them. And so non-compliance is not just about purchasing from your local farmer as opposed to a big box store, or not paying your taxes. Non-compliance is the conscious decision not to react. The conscious decision to act with your best interest in mind. Whenever we make a reactive decision, they're always bad. And if you look back in your life, you'll realize that even if it was a small mess you had to clean up, you still had to clean up a mess. It's because when we assume we are in an emotional state, when we are angry and frustrated, we are in an emotional state. It's what keeps the stock market going. Now, there are some hardwired urges in us that they use against us. One of them is our need to survive. One of the ways in which we do that is we copy the most successful in our group. We copy what they do, all the way down to the way that they look. We congregate around them, and we continue to stay around them as close as possible. Now, you could either be part of their entourage, or you could be one of their fans. But if you are in either boat, you have identified this person, or this idea, or this object, as better than you. And so in order for you to be successful like they are, or that is, you must copy it and stay as close as possible. It's why when you walk through a mall and you see a picture of Demi Moore wearing a pair of jeans, you immediately want to have this urge to, you may suppress it and walk by, but you instantly have this urge to go into the store and buy the jeans, if you think Demi Moore looks good in those jeans. So because they use this tactic against us in marketing, they are able to keep us in compliance, because it is always about whether or not they've been able to elicit an emotional response and if you're going to act on that emotional response. If they've played their cards right, you will. And if you do, you're going to do something that you're going to regret later on. Now, I want to bring up an example of this, which is Live Aid in 1985. Now, somewhere between $65 billion and $68 billion have been acquired by Live Aid since 1985. But in 1985, the money that they earned was given to the military, and portions of that money were given to food rescue initiatives to steer Ethiopian refugees out of their homeland and away from the battlefield. This was a forced population transfer. They did this because they had reason to believe that the people who lived there, who have the right to be there, the U.S. was invading, had put together some guerrilla armies, is how they were referred to, the dissenters, the terrorists, whatever you want to call it. And they thought that the people of Ethiopia were helping this small group of people who were fighting for their homeland. So they moved everyone out. Now, Live Aid supported this monetarily and paid for the murder of 150 to 200,000 Ethiopians during this forced relocation. I'm sure that no one who gave money to Live Aid expected that their money would kill 200,000 Ethiopians.
I can't imagine that was the plan. You tell me that Willie Nelson participated in such a thing?
The unfortunate part about all of this is it takes the participation of good people. And when you have something orchestrated on a massive scale like Live Aid or any of these large charities that end up funding things that the donors had no intention of funding, it takes the belief of good people who are participating, who are on a need-to-know basis, and they don't know what's going on behind the curtain. I'll give you an example. Bob Geldof used the example of a young lady who was saved from starvation because of Live Aid in 1985. However, she was actually saved by a photojournalist who made a documentary about her in October 1984. So her life was saved by that journalist. The Live Aid and Bob Geldof crew took that footage and scooped her up and used her as a puppet, as a mascot for Live Aid. And it worked. Because even though this is common knowledge, nobody seems to care. And that is how insidious this whole thing is. It elicits an emotional response. And folks, when we have an emotional response to someone or some idea, the funny thing that we do is we take it into ourselves and make it part of our personal paradigm so that it no longer becomes an argument over an idea or a person. It becomes an argument over justification for our personal existence. That is a very, very powerless place for us to be. If we choose not to react, if we choose to make conscious decisions based on logic, if we choose to take in information and step back for a minute and think about it, or call a friend that we think that their advice would be good for us, or anything other than reacting, we're going to make an informed decision based on what benefits us, not them. If you go into a department store and you need a toaster oven and you walk out with a convection oven, you've been marketed to. We need to stop walking out of the store with convection ovens when we're intending to purchase toaster ovens.
an interesting thought. You know, for years I've considered myself kind of a critic of commercials. You know, I'm the kind of guy who watches a commercial and I look at it and I say, well, let's see, did that commercial really do its job? Did it interest me in the product? I mean, was I aware of what they were trying to sell? You know, and so often I would see commercials where, you know, I'd come away from it, I'm not even sure what those guys were trying to sell me. Other times I'd look at that commercial and say, you know, those guys really did a good job in that commercial. Yes, I'm intrigued by their offer. I wonder, how powerful is advertising these days? I mean, do you really think that people look at advertisements nowadays and take that stuff seriously? Or are they more or less like me sitting on the couch saying, boy, that commercial sucked. I don't even know what they were trying to sell me. Now, what do you think?
I would love to believe that more people are like you. However, the majority of our global society is purchasing things based on an emotional response. It may be that the commercial doesn't seem to make sense because it's there to elicit that emotional response, and then they just put the product placement at the end of it or the logo at the end of it because psychologically that's all they have to do. You feel the emotion, you see the image, in your brain there becomes a connection between that image and that emotion, and so they can just reconnect that bridge anytime they want. Once they've made that connection in your mind, they can call it into mobility at any time. You okay, know, so kind that, of like when they hypnotize you and they use those trigger words and you all of a sudden start quacking like a duck.
So that really, you know, nice looking young hunk on the TV, sprays himself down with that magical spray, and goes out to the bar, and 15 women are just hanging all over him. Are you telling me that's why I've got 37 cans of that body spray in my closet upstairs that I've never used?
Well, let me give you a little cautionary tale. Josiah Thompson, who is an author, was researching John Updike in the 1970s because he was writing a column for the New York Times, and it was about this mysterious umbrella man connected to the JFK assassination. And it was a clear, sunny day, and this umbrella man, who he was known as after Josiah Thompson exposed this, was standing where the shots had originated, and he was dressed all in black with a black umbrella. And all of a sudden, conspiracy theories started floating around about this person who was seen in the Zapruder film and several different pictures as well. And one person even published a book with a diagram of the umbrella that had a shooting apparatus coming out of the top, so the umbrella was actually a gun. Well, Josiah Thompson put out a call publicly for Umbrella Man to make himself known. And in 1978... Umbrella Man, whose real name is Louis Stephen Mitt, spoke and testified at Congress explaining his open umbrella as a visual protest. It was against the appeasement policies of Joseph P. Kennedy, JFK's father, when he was ambassador to the court of St. James in 1938-1939. The reference was to Neville Chamberlain's umbrella that was captured in pictures, with regard to that incident with Joseph P. Kennedy. So the moral of the story here, folks, is this is a cautionary tale. We can assume anything we want, but once we have an emotional response to a incident, a person, a place, a thing, an idea, we then finish their sentence for them, and it no longer matters what the truth is. The truth is that this gentleman, Louis Stephen Mitt, was protesting something that had nothing to do with the assassination, even though he was standing in the area where the shots ended up originating.
Fascinating. I wasn't aware of that. You know, I heard stories about Umbrella Man, and I just shrugged my shoulders. You know, yet another conspiracy theory. You know, I didn't pay a whole lot of attention to it. But, I was aware that there was a guy there with an umbrella on a crystal clear day. But then I think about it, and I quite often toss a raincoat or an umbrella into my car as I'm getting ready to roll off down the road, even if it's a bright, sunshiny day, because in my area, you never know what it's going to be like early afternoon. So I thought, okay, so this guy's out with his umbrella. Big deal. Why is everybody making a big deal out of this fact? You know, yeah, what can I say? I know it was the rage for about a week there that, you know, Umbrella Man had something, kind of like, the chauffeur had something to do with it, you know?
Right. We're still arguing about JFK. We're still arguing about 9/11. We're arguing about Fukushima. We'll probably be arguing about it for decades to come. There's no cohesion because we're all reacting. We all have a set of beliefs that we believe to be true, and when someone challenges them, they're not challenging the beliefs, they're challenging us personally. Because if the belief is wrong, then we are wrong. And if we are wrong, then what's our purpose?
Well, you know, that is a good point, you know, on this 9/11 issue. I'm constantly pulled into arguments about, whether it was space-based beam weapons or micro-nukes or this or that or the other thing. And, you know, I shrug my shoulders and, maybe, but, you know, I think that all of us, okay, you with your space-based beam weapons and you with your nanothermite and you with your micro-nukes and you with the Israelis did it and you with the Saudis did it. One thing we should all be able to sit down and have a beer over is that the most bogus story out there is the one palmed off on us by our government officials. Now, whether it was space-based beam weapons or nanothermite or micro-nukes or whatever, we may never know. But all of us can pretty much agree that the story we were fed was nonsense. And based on that story, this nation has killed millions of people. Probably perfectly innocent people who had nothing to do with it. So, you know, that is something that everybody could agree on instead of being threatened by the fact that, oh, well, he doesn't believe space-based weapons did it, so he must be, you know, an agent provocateur or disinformation agent or whatever. I get a little annoyed with that.
Well, this is a problem. We don't understand the definition. I was told today that an article of mine could not be shared by this individual on Facebook because it was a conspiracy. Absolutely it is. Folks, the definition of conspiracy is that two or more people get together to do evil things. Go look it up. It's, you can Google it, start to page it, whatever digital communication you choose to use or browser. By the way, all of it's tracked and traced. It doesn't matter. Digital communication is tracked and traced, period. But yes, it is a conspiracy because the article was about how MasterCard and Visa have decided that by 2015, October to be exact, the United States will have chip-to-pin credit cards, period, or else. That is a conspiracy. Conspiracy is not a bad word. The problem is that nobody knows what the definition is. Or let me back that up a little bit. Very few people know the actual definition of conspiracy, and so it's become a derogatory statement. And then people who accept conspiracy theories accept that derogatory statement as if it's true and take it into themselves emotionally and then defend themselves against someone who basically, folks, let's boil it down. They don't know how to use a dictionary. Is that your problem? No. Should you take it into yourself? No. Do you know how to use a dictionary? Yes. So what we know to be true and what we believe to be true are two different things. What we react to and what we consciously make a decision to do are two different things. When we emotionally react and act upon that emotion, bad things happen. When we consciously make a decision based on logic, which is beneficial to us, good things happen. Which one would you like? Bad things to happen or good things to happen? It starts with you.
So what did it wind up? You were not allowed to share this article?
This person did not want to share my article because of it. And that's okay.
And this was an individual's decision, not a decision.
An individual's decision.
This was not a decision universally by Facebook.
No, actually, Facebook censored me 3 days ago because I posted an article that I'd written last year exposing how RT is funded by RIA Novosti, which is the original Ministry of Propaganda that was begun in 1944 in Russia. Facebook didn't like that one, so they wouldn't let me post it.
Okay. I mean, I thought that was common knowledge. I mean, is it, hey, what am I? Well, of course RT is an arm of the Russian government, as MSNBC, CBS, and most of the networks here appear to be carrying water for our government policy. So, you know, I would say that most major media in most nations of the world have evolved, whether, you know, by hook or by crook or whatever, but they seem to have evolved into propaganda arms of their respective governments. Why would people think any differently?
Well, this was on the heels of Liz Wall, I think is how you pronounce her last name, quitting RT, and then Abby Martin coming out and making statements, qualifying things as if we didn't understand. This is all propaganda, folks. They don't call it a show for nothing. The Bill O'Reilly show is a show. It's entertainment. That's not how Bill O'Reilly really thinks. Nobody knows him personally, and those who do don't talk about it. So they let him play character on TV. It's a character. It's a show. Now, if you remember back in during the 80s with Gorbachev and Reagan, there were lots and lots of things going on like this that's starting to happen right now. It's called the preparation of Cold War II, the sequel. That's where we're headed. So you're going to see a lot of, you know, freedom fries and a lot of other great things coming out of the media to boist U.S. independence and the American flag and democracy, even though we're a constitutional republic and democracy is mob rule. So I don't know where they equated the two, but somehow in public schools it makes sense. Maybe Common Core has something to do with that. I don't know.
Or No Child Left Behind, which basically came to mean No Child Excels. Suzanne, we're running out of time, and I want to make sure that you get an opportunity to do that all-important blatant self-promotion. If people are interested in what we're discussing and they wish to find out more, where can they go to find out more about your materials?
My website is OccupyCorporatism.com. It's a daily news website. I also have begun a news agency because I think that that's something independent media is lacking. And I have some wonderful, great people who believe in my vision and have agreed to contribute. Dr. Rima Libo and Thomas Sheridan and Dane Wigington and Charlotte Iserby and many others. The USIndependent.com is the website. And thank you very much for having me on the show and joining me, Mr. Gary, who is wonderful.
Well, you know, if you ask my wife, I'm not so sure I'm wonderful, but, you know, I'll do until something better comes along.
I'm sure your wife and my husband could swap stories.
Well, you know, after 37 years, she hasn't thrown me out the door yet, so I guess the pool boy just wasn't all that great after all. Suzanne, thank you so much for your participation in the United We Strike Marathon. We hope to. Are you going to hang out with us for Roundtable, which is coming up right after you?
I wouldn't miss it for the world.
Very good. I'm going to go ahead and break the connection with you now, play a little bit of music, and I'll be calling you back in about a minute and a half.